thanks all for attending, all of you that will see the offline, online or also offline later. And this talk, well, Dasan, you said about doing an introduction, isn't it? Do you want to do it?
No, I think mostly people know you, but yeah, you know, let's do a quick. So mostly it's talk about, you know, the working offline without leaving Odoo with PWA Catch, right? So maybe you're going to show the sales circuit and, you know, sales rep to ourselves. And Pedro Beza over here is like CTO and co-owner of the Technativa. So I think it's a very interesting topic. And yeah, over to you. Very excited.
Okay, thanks for the presentation. And yes, as he has said, the idea is to present here what we are working now for one of our customers, that which goal is to work offline. First of all, let's see what is the classic online Odoo screen that we all know. How is done? We have our browser, our Odoo client, that is run over a browser, and we have internet for connecting to our Odoo server. Sometimes the server is on our same host, but it's not the usual thing. But at the end, we use network technology for communicating with the server and do all the interactions. And data is preserved on a Postgres DB. So this is the classic scheme we have. And now, why do we need offline capabilities? No, it's a question that can arise and say, hey, I have internet connection in all places. Why I need this? Well, that statement is not really true or not true for all the possibilities. So sometimes this connection is not possible, and especially for field service works. Our customer, for example, is a customer of the restaurants, bar, and hotels retailer chain. So they need to take orders on kitchens that are very deep on the ground, on the second or third floor under the ground. So they don't have connection there. Also, all the connections have improved a lot. But it's not only a question of connection, but also the connection speed. You can have connection, but not very good speed. So assuring a constant speed makes us to provide a good experience. So that's also important. And other times, it can be that we need an isolated environment by any means. It's not the case of our customer, but I have already heard about other requirements of a specific customer that will require to isolate the environment, and then when you have a trusted connection, to communicate and transfer data. So, what is the classic offline scheme that people uses for these requirements? Well, you have your browser with direct internet connection, as said on the classic online scheme, and you are a new piece on your puzzle. You need an independent application for handling this offline thing. That application has its storage. You don't worry about that on Odoo itself, and has the capability to disconnect and in one moment to somehow synchronize or something similar. Well, this is not bad at all. It gets to the requirement you are getting to work offline, but it has several problems. What is the problems we identify? Disconnected features. What this means? You have to develop again. You have to put the features you want to have on this independent application, you have to have it replicated on that application. Also, you have a perfect solution on the site also. Another problem is that you are going by force to use a different user interface. It's not possible, or it will require more work to do an interface equal to the other one. So this will mean that you will need to learn two things, working offline and working online. This is not a problem always, because you can have your field service or someone only using the offline application, so they only know that. But when you want a fluid environment, when you want to work offline or online, no matter what, the different user interface can be a problem. You also have the problem on non-compact updates. If you, for example, migrate from version 12 to version 13 on Odoo, you will need to somehow change the independent application for adapting to this new version. So it will require a coordination of all parts, and the problem that means do the things several times. So we are again on the need of maintaining two things. So let's design another offline approach. What is the paradigm we have followed for designing this? First, we have the features on the server, not on the client side. So we avoid something like the post of Odoo. The Odoo post is offline, but it requires to duplicate somehow the business logic on the client side, or it has a specific developments for that part. We try to avoid this. Obviously, applying this paradigm will require to have some constraints. We cannot do everything, but let's see further after this initial thought. Also, the idea is to synchronize data, not to update code or application. These updates can happen because you are updating the core or the framework behind this technology, but not for updating the features you need to have. Another paradigm is to make use of the Odoo web client architecture and also features. So we reuse the same user interface. We can make use of this rich feature set of widgets, and so on. And the last one, I didn't remember if there is one more, is the centralization of changes. When I update, when I migrate Odoo, when I do everything, I do it once. I don't have to coordinate or make another thing in another place. Okay, so with these paradigms in mind, let's introduce our Odoo PWA cache scheme. PWA are the initials for a technology that we haven't invented. It's a standard web technology that is very trending lately, because a lot of work is being done here, both on browsers for supporting it, but also on companies and big companies making use of this technology for similar approaches that the one we have taken. Okay, so using that web technology as base, our cache scheme is going to be this one. We have the same Odoo web client using the browser, and I'm putting this because unfortunately today only Chrome is supporting the whole PWA feature set we need. So this is only compatible with Chrome, not with Firefox, And certainly we haven't tried with Safari, but I think it's not going to be also compatible. Other Chromium-related browsers should be compatible, like Edge, Brave, and so on. And on this web client, we are adding a layer here that is called the PWA cache that will mean the framework we need for doing this offline work. And obviously, this requires a local DB that for storing things, because if not, everything will blow up when we, for example, exit the browser or restart our device. Okay, so we have this local DB. For more details, it's a hybrid database. We are mixing IndexedDB, that is also another standard web technology, and the simple SQL database, the most simplest one. But I don't remember. If I remember later, I will tell you. Another one, and this one is injected through a JavaScript library because we need a high performance SQL application. And IndexedDB is not a full set SQL. It's only a way to store things and sequentially get the information. So this one, the performance was very, very bad. So we have the advantage of being standard and very fast on storing, but not very fast on reading. So as I said, it's a mix of both. And the rest of the scheme is the same. We are accessing internet if we have it, but with that layer, we can avoid it. So more technically, what we have is this. We have the Odoo web client, and this Odoo web client is sending the same kind of request supposedly to the server. But we are catching such calls, and in our layer, we are reinterpreting them, maybe reading from local, or maybe simply bypassing to internet. Okay, so that's the technical scheme behind this. So what we have concentrated on implementing this layer is to understand all of these primitives. They are a lot, and they more or less they have to mimic the URL we have on the server side. Obviously, it's not the same complex URL, but only the one that requires to interpret, assess these calls. Let's see how this works in real. So I have it on my own computer, but this is the more logical thing is to use devices like tablets or mobile phones. So I'm showcasing here, but it will be the same. The flow is to access the regular URL you have, and then the system, the browser says that it's an application, and if you want to install it, if you click on yes, this will provide an icon that is put on your applications on the device, and then you can start such application. This application will be borderless, so you won't find the URL and so on. This is provided by the PWA technology, and starting the application in this mode, you have to select if you want to go online or offline. This is because also you can be with connection, maybe you decide to go offline for not having to synchronize data on a slow connection. So going offline starts immediately. Let's see. Okay. And if I go online, I have to open it. Here it is. If you select online, what is performed before is a synchronization of the MIDI data. Maybe there are some new records, maybe there are some new precached data that is synchronized. Okay, so with this, even if we are online, you can see here, when we do the works, the first thing that is checked is if we have on our local cache the things. So you can see that the connection or the things that we do are very fast, because all of this is performed locally. Only when the data is not here is queried to the server to fetch this data. Okay, so I have been very quick doing that, but this is a special view that we have prepared for this customer for inputting the sales orders. So what we have here, a very small screen only putting customer, and a special widget that we have also developed and it's already available on OCA repositories for being able to search quickly and to add units very quickly about the products. This widget is called Product Picker, and you don't need PWA for using this, but in this case, it's all put together for getting this thing. So we can save, and being online, this will be dumped to the server. But now let's go to offline mode. So if we are offline, we can see here. If we create another one, we have the same kind of performance. But when we save, you can see here that the record is offline. And if we go here, we will see that we have three records to be synced. Okay, why three records? One sale order and two sale order lines. This is a quite technical for users, but for now we have decided to preserve it for having all the information there. And we can simply close the application and start again. Or, I do it very quickly, and the service worker that this is the technology behind doesn't detect and close the connection. So now it is. And if we click on online, you can see that in that moment, the three records that we have pending have been synchronized, and now we are working again online. Okay, so this is more or less a brief showcase of the scheme. It's cool, isn't it? I think it is. So let's continue a bit about the internals, because as I have some more time than on the audio experience stuff, I'm going to dig a bit more how this technically works. Also, we have talked about reducing the web client. We need to instruct this layer how to act. And how is this instructions? Well, we create a special definition that is called PWA cache definition records. This is on our system. In this case here, the PW cache, and this, let's put it a bit more bigger. And what is this? These are different type of definition that instructs the web client. Let's start with the simplest one. The model, the type, the cache model. What is this one? Well, we are instructing the this layer to get offline this model. Which model? The model contact. So when synchronizing, it will query if there are new partners or some of them change, and then dump them. So with this, we can make offline a part if we provides all the models in both indeed. So you can see that we have the partners, we have the product template, the product price list, all the models that are involved on the sales flow. We need them. Okay, you know, we cannot do with a model that is not made online, but the definition is very simple. We put it a name, we say model, and which model. We can do another thing, that is to provide a domain for restricting the records that we are going to put. For example, this is very useful because you can think, why not letting the user to provide the ones that are allowed to access? Well, for example, you can see the answer here. We only need to synchronize the last month sales order. We don't want the whole history because it takes a lot of space. So let's restrict the domain, saying we only want that from this date, the last month date. Okay, so with this, we can restrict these things. If not, you will get all the records you have access according to report rules. And another thing we have included as feature is to only make use of this record if you belong to one of the allowed groups. Why also this duplication or this overlap with the standard warrant? In some occasion, we will need to restrict also some kind of records of this type to the groups put. We will see later examples on this. So this allows to have that fine grained control. If we don't put anything, again, the standard permission system will apply. More things we can put. Here I don't have more, most of them are the model. The following one are very technical one. I'm not seeing there because they are internal, but let's see. And group by this type. See? Okay, here you have. For example, we need to precache this reference of XML for having locally the Cook Web definition. This is something that is performed by the web client, and it's fixed on the same version. Maybe you are adding, for example, the web environment ribbon. This one you see here also need a client Cook Web. So you will need to perform this PW cache record definition for storing them and being able to cache this thing. It's very technical, and the base module is providing the ones you need without extra modules, so you won't have any problem in that one. Post and get are the same. We need something that is get through the standard HTTP get and post. For example, this image is get that way. Okay, so let's go to the more complicated one, that is the cache definition for on-chain. What is an on-chain? Well, when you do something on the web client is asking the server what happens with the change you have made. And this is technically called on-chain. This on-chain is performed both for code you have provided for doing some logic, but also on computed fields that reacts on a dependency chain. So for example, if you have a computed field that depends on the product on a sale order line, when you call on-chain product ID from the client, this computed is also triggered and returns on the same values return the value of that computed field. Okay, so also on the server side, we have two tools, the computed fields or also related fields and the on-chain methods On the web client, it's more simple. You only say, hey, I have changed this. Return what you consider. And on the server, this is a process and return. So, as said, one of the paradigms is to not develop code on the client part. What is the only option for this? Well, precache all the possible combinations for this thing. Maybe you are now thinking, well, that's crazy. There can be a lot of combinations. Well, that's true. Depending on the use case, maybe the combinations are absurd. We have in this customer this problem. On the product, they have about 3,000 products and about 8,000 customers. Doing the combination, it gets to 20 million of combinations. So that's very huge. The framework can do it, but the mobile requires to store this information. So in that case, we have made some simplification. So let's see this some change, or let's start with a simple one. When we are putting the customer on the sales order, the price list is fixed, and for this customer, also the address, the shipping address, and so on. So we have created the sales order on chain of the partner in the field, and we are providing here what are the fields that will characterize or will define the on-chain. So we are discriminating here what are the important data to be passed to the server for differentiating the combination. In this case, it's very simple. Only the partner ID we have selected is the one that determines the rest of the values. So we put that one. And then our cache is stored on the server side. Which cache? All the partners are queried according to this expression, and an on-chain over these parameters is performed, and the results are stored in a table. Okay, we can force, let's see here, queue. As you can see, we are using the queue job technology. So if I enqueue this full refresh, I will see that a job for each of the possible values is stored here. For partner ID, 39, 32, and so on. So these values are processed. You can see it's very quick at the end, but if you have 1,000 or more, it can take some time. So this has now stored the return values. And when we synchronize our PW, these values are transferred to our local DB. So when the web client is executing the same on chain, we take the local value, not the not querying to the server. Okay, so this approach has these cons, but it's very useful for not having to worry about the stack of modules you have installed. Because imagine you have a module that is changing the partner shipping ID, the shipping address that is put. If you, on the classic approach, you would need to develop something on your application to modify the behavior. In this case, no, we only need to refresh the return values. And the return values will take into account these server modifications. Okay, so let's go to a more complicated one. That is when you are sending the product on the sales order line. And in this case, it depends on more variables. Why? Because it depends on the product you are selecting, but also on the price list and partner. Why? Because the price list is determining the prices you are going to use. And the partner is something that is passed along the on-changes for determining the language. So in this customer, we have made a simplification. We are only querying by these two, but also passing one partner for not having an error. If not, we are not getting the values, but this this column that puts this possible makes that we are not using this as discriminant. So this allows us to have a manageable quantity of records. We are 1 million and 500. If not, as I said, it would be 20 million of records. But this has two constraints. We are not querying by quantity. If you have prices, different prices per quantity, this definition doesn't, it's not valid. And also, it's not taking into account several languages, because the language is at partner level. So for this customer, it is acceptable because they don't have multi-language here. So see how we have to decide, designing this record depending on the use cases. And with this, all the combination is performed, and it's going to have more more possible combinations. So let's see. And now, in this case, this product, this price list. This product and this price list. Another product, another. There is only one price list, so there's not too much there. But this is the scheme. Okay. So this is very good. You have click here and get the first cash value. But what happened when the data change? You change a price, you create a new product, and so on. So for this, we have this part, update triggers. This update triggers section allows to define how to update these things or directly create things. So we can see that, hey, when we create, update, or remove a product, you have to perform something. What? Well, in this case, we are providing here the same expression that will discriminate what we want to sell. And in this case, is the product that has been updated or unlinked or created. And on the update scene, we have also a discriminant values that will trigger it, because maybe we are changing an irrelevant data and compute again this. Is costly and we don't want to do that. So only updating the name will require to change that, or the list price, or the full code, or so on. And we can see that this gets a bit more complicated when the updated item is it's a bit different. For example, a price list item that is affecting price. In this case, we have to query the scope of the item and according to that, return the affected records. Okay? So with this, we will get an update seamlessly. We don't have to worry about having the latest cache values. So I think this is a very smart mechanism that has, as everything in this life, some cons and some constraints. But in general, we are providing here a good framework for doing all of these things. But not always everything can be modeled this way. Why? Because let's go to this one. No. This one. Okay, sometimes these on-chains are not computable. Why? Because we can have infinite values. For example, when inputs are numbers. We have some modules that are the secondary unit set of modules that provides another unit to take the order. For example, you have units, but you also have boxes. And you say a box is 10 units. So when you have one box, you have to put 10 boxes. When you have 10 units, when you have you put two boxes, you have to put 20 box units, and so on. So computing this has no sense, because you will have infinite values. So we have provided another tool for also you need to provide some code. This code is very compact and is only informed one time, that is on the server. So you have this specific type that is on chain with formula. So what you are providing here is a piece of code for performing this operation. So we have to break a bit our initial paradigms for performing these things, but they are very, very isolated and for very specific things. Okay, so here we need to provide JavaScript code for doing this. And you can see this one is for the secondary unit. You only need to get to see the factor to transfer data and provide that one. Okay, and it's only provided for not triggering the rest of the changes if it's different. Okay, so this is executed on the web plugin path and provided the same as if you have sent to the server this query. Okay, so this open also. Do you want to say something?
I have a question, Pedro, and that is related to the models, because some of the models are dependent on each other, but yeah, they are forming a circular dependency. That means model one is dependent on model two, and model two is dependent on model three, and model three is again dependent on model one. We found that when we analyzed the Udo database structure. Have you overcome that kind of situation? Because that's creating a circular dependency, and that is, in our view, not really resolvable. What is your answer to that?
For now, there is no tool for analyzing this. What we are doing? Well, we are setting this by hand, respecting that dependencies. So imagine you are adding something depending on contact, and you are not declaring contact as something to be put offline. You will get an error on that case, on the web client. But we are not providing for now a sanity check for that. Hey, you are trying to make offline something that depends on this. Okay? But there is no dependency, hard dependency at all on this. What this means? That we don't get the recourse on such dependency change. We are only saving integer values. So if you have a sales order that is for that customer, we are only dumping to our local storage customer ID equal to 3 to 5. It's on runtime when that 3 or 5 integer value is then queried to the REST partner table and then get the value. And if you are if the web client is not able to fetch this REST partner value, you will get an error on that case. So for now, you have to be the responsible for providing a good a healthy record definition, PWU record definition. For now, on the scope we are doing, this is provided on the modules we are sending to OCA. So if you install same PWA cache module, you will have all the needed models for performing sales on standard. If you have other kind of of models there, you will need to put it. But this has been also designed to be extendable. So, for example, we have this secondary unit case that is another module, and this module has another module definition for PWA cache, but you only need to install these modules. You don't need to tweak anything depending on the case. Okay, so this is, that's why you see all these subtables here for being able to to provide further expressions of the triggers and so on, if you want, on subsequent modules. Okay, so I'm not sure. Do we have more time, or are we past?
Hey Pedro, yeah. So we have like a couple of minutes, 2 minutes, I guess.
Yeah. Okay. So basically, this is the architecture. Of course, there is a lot more. You can imagine that this is very huge, but the fundamentals are this one. One last thing to comment before passing to questions. We are doing this for data fetching, for inputting data. Of course, you cannot do offline operations like let's reconcile statements. This is something that can be done easily because there is a few interactions. Other things, let's validate pickings and then subtract stock and so on. These kind of operations are not covered because the important thing to be done offline is the data fetching. For example, to fill the picking. And then when you get online, then perform the operation. This is, for example, what we have done for sales order. They take the sales order, and when synchronizing, they are confirmed. And then trigger the rest of the thing on online mode. Create the picking, the procurements, and so on. You can imagine that this kind of thing is not performed here. So this is the last thing I want to clarify. So now I'm open to questions, and I hope you have liked it. This. We can say that this is as all the technical work we do on OCA, and we have as pull request. This is the main one, but you can search on OCA by PWA. _ cache for finding the corresponding pull request.
Hey, Pedro, great job. You mentioned that the reconcile would not be working. I fully understand. How about if you post something, like if you post an invoice, is that something that you would cover? I mean, are you going to provide the business logic to do the bulk post, for instance, for subsequent lines?
The idea is not to provide this thing because it's not something that you need to do offline. Well, you can argue on this because you need it to do it. But we are not focusing on this because that will need to recreate the business logic on the client side. We can have tools like the on-chain with formula you have seen, but the idea is to delay this operation to be done on batch when synchronizing, and only let the most time-consuming task, that is inputting data, to the offline work. Okay, you can see that it's very fluid. You can pass from what. There is a lot of echo. You can see that it's very easy to pass from online to offline. So on our example, they go to the kitchen, take the order, and when they go up and are on the outside, they click again on online, and they have the sales order confirmed and passed to the central for providing the picking and so on.
Hey, hey everyone. So I guess thanks, Pedro. I mean, we don't have like more time permit. So, but maybe, you know, we have like few questions, but we could take directly to Discord channel.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe, you know, we could jump back to the next. I guess Ben is waiting in the line.
Okay, perfect. So thanks all for attending. And see you around GitHub.
Thanks, Pedro. Thanks again. Very informative. Bye.
Bye.